must be remembered as the director of LSE. I am not saying that because I'm an LSE person, but because that was his most internationally well-known role. And of course, as a great European intellectual, a man who cared about Europe as a whole and the prospect for Europe.
Lord Desai, well, we're joined now by Professor Laurie Taylor of the University of London. Laurie, how significant was Ralph Dahrendorf's contribution to the study of sociology, your discipline?
It almost totally depends upon that book we've heard about, Class and Class Conflict in Industrial Society, which came out in 1959. It's the year which makes it interesting. I doubt if people study it very intensely now. It probably just seems a stepping stone. But when it arrived, it just came at a particular moment when there was a disenchantment generally with Marx. There was a feeling that, well, Marx's ideology hadn't really worked, the working class hadn't risen up, you know, we were back in the same old place, so Marx didn't seem to be working. At the same time, there's a great dissatisfaction with schools of sociology coming from the United States, led by someone like Talcott Parsons, who said, well, everything was for the best, there was a nice consensus, we all got along together, we all subscribed to the same values. So people were a bit feeling, well, what can we do now? You know, what is the answer to the way in which society works? And then at that particular moment, Dahrendorf comes along, and he is a sort of Marxist. I mean, he wants to say, yes, he does believe in conflict. Unlike Talcott Parsons, who said, we all subscribe to the same values, we all get along very well, that's why there isn't a war of all against all. Dahrendorf came along and said, no, there is order in society, but there's also a great deal of conflict. In fact, the whole business of managing society is to allow these conflicts, in fact, to find some way of expressing themselves. Now, this fitted very well with the students, you see, because at the time, the students were rather, you know, the beginning of the 60s, wanting to sort of like get involved in revolutionary activities, but they clearly weren't the proletariat. They could hardly rise up as the organized working class and say, look, we're all Marxists. They didn't really fit. But when they read their Dahrendorf, what they found in Dahrendorf was Dahrendorf was saying that, look, society is full of interest groups, people with certain sorts of power over other people. And at times, they decide to exert that power. Often they don't bother with it. I mean, a nice example recently that would fit Bedell with Dahrendorf is the electorate, because at the moment the electorate don't seem to operate together, but confronted by the sort of scandals over MPs' expenses, all of a sudden the electorate feel that they're together, we'll punish those lot, we'll deal with them, and they deal with them. Now, of course, the students can say, oh, just a minute, we're in a position of power as well, we're oppressed by all those administrators over in that comfortable administration block across the lake, we're oppressed by all our professors, let's rise up. So it's not altogether surprising that Dahrendorf stepped over the bodies of students as he entered his office, because to some extent it almost provided them the license for their behaviour in his book.
And were his views influential? Did they spread quite widely when they came out at that time?
Well, every single student who ever studied social science in the 60s had to answer the question, how does functionalism account for social change? Now, this was a reference to the way in which these conservative theories of how society held together were being challenged by conflict theories. And Dahrendorf led a whole new school of conflict theories who attempted to say, look, there is conflict going on in the world, there is conflict going on in society, our job is to manage it in as liberal a way as we possibly can. We've got to allow people to be able to assert themselves, to have their demonstrations, to stand out on the streets, but we've got to, at the same time, you know, we've got to make certain that this doesn't throw all of society up in the air, that we don't actually create the revolution.
And did they have an impact on you? Because you would have been studying his work, presumably.
Well, I used to carry them around. They were slightly talismanic to me because I was confronted by two or three people in my department who were Parsonians. In other words, they were great believers in the way in which values all held us together. We could have a nice consensual society and get along. And I needed a stick to beat them with. And the brown copy of Class and Class Conflict in Industrial Society was just such a weapon.
Laurie Taylor, thank you very much indeed for joining us on Last Word. Now, Dorothy, she was one of a large number of attractive young women. Talk about the fact that, you know, did she miss her glamorous lifestyle, for example?
She loved that, but I never heard her say that she was sorry she gave it up or I wish I had done differently. We always teased about the fact that we felt she had that twinkle, that Hollywood twinkle in her eyes.
Mary Hedeman remembering Dorothy Layton, who's died aged 96. Now, Yehoshua Zettler was either a dangerous terrorist or a hero of the State of Israel, depending on your point of view. He was a member of the Stern Gang, also known as the Lehi, who waged a campaign of violence in the 1940s to secure the establishment of the State of Israel and force the British out of the region. Zettler was the Stern Gang's commander of operations in Jerusalem. In particular, he led the operation to assassinate a Swedish diplomat in 1948, which he thought would favour their cause. Zettler had been born in a settlement north of Tel Aviv and joined the Israeli resistance to British rule as a teenager. He was imprisoned in 1940 for his part in a bank robbery, but escaped from custody and went on the run. Professor David Cesarani of Royal Holloway, University of London, told me what sort of people the Stern Gang were.
They were not just ideologically fanatical, they were ruthless killers, and they used the most violent techniques of what we would call terrorism in their attempt to break the British will to remain in Palestine.
Could you give me some examples of the kind of activities that Zettler and his colleagues would have been involved in?
Well, during 1939-1940, Avraham Stern sent his men out to assassinate members of the British mandatory police force, mainly British policemen serving in the CID in Palestine. These men were gunned down on the streets, they were blown up. Their hatred towards the British became absolutely unbounded. By this time, there were a number of men in their ranks who had had military training during the Second World War. They had bomb makers who were devilishly clever. They developed the roadside bomb, the car bomb, the truck bomb, indeed the letter bomb. One of the leading members of Lehi claimed to have invented the letter bomb. And they wreaked havoc on the British administration, the police force, the British army in 1946-47.
And then in 1948, there was this assassination of the Swedish diplomat who'd been sent by the UN to negotiate between Israel and the Palestinians.
I believe, I think they have the right to believe that we sooner or later, might be sooner, can get the settlement and stop the war in Palestine.
One aspect of Bernadotte's plan, which really angered the Stern Gang, was that he didn't want to include Jerusalem in the State of Israel.
That's right, but Bernadotte's mission initially was simply to negotiate a ceasefire. The Jews feared that they would be deprived of the Negev desert, an empty area that they hoped they would be able to settle with Jews coming from Europe. But Bernadotte also proposed that the UN should control Jewish immigration to the Jewish state, and that was utterly unacceptable to the Jews. The plan that Bernadotte put forward was never a runner, but it did alienate Jewish opinion, and the Lehi group particularly developed a paranoid fear that he was going to steal the victories that they'd won so far.
In 1948, Yehoshua Zettler led the operation to assassinate the Swedish diplomat Count Folke Bernadotte, who was acting as a mediator on behalf of the United Nations. Zettler's daughter, Efrat Heyman, told me what drove her father to take such extreme action.
Jerusalem was very, very dear to his heart, and he thought that the state of Israel can't be a real state without Jerusalem, because he didn't consider Jerusalem as a territory, but as a symbol of the Jewish people.
So did he tell you about the events leading up to the assassination of Count Bernadotte on September the 17th, 1948?
I heard him many times speak about it at home and with other people, and it's very important to say that he didn't consider it a murder of Bernadotte, but rather an executing Bernadotte.
What was it that he objected to about this man, who was, after all, a United Nations mediator?
He saw it as the enemy agent, in the sense that Bernadotte was against, of course, the Jewish state, in a very spoken way. There was no doubt about it. And especially what my father was concerned about Jerusalem, and Bernadotte was one of the people who said that Jerusalem won't be a Jewish city, but it will not be a part of the Jewish state. And he thought, and I think he was right in thinking like this, because many people say that Bernadotte was a real danger to the future of Israel as a state, and Jerusalem in particular. And this was very important for my father as a soldier in the war.
Some people have described him as a terrorist. What do you think of that?
I don't agree at all. I think my father was a soldier of the Israeli nation. And terrorism is something else. They fought for the nation of Israel and Jerusalem after the Holocaust, for all the refugees to have a place to live in.
These men and women believed in the gun as the solution to most problems. And that is a mindset that still divides the Jews in Israel profoundly.